the greatest professional wrestlers from throughout the world.
Welcome to World Championship Wrestling.
This is Extreme.
We've got a blockbuster for you.
Oh, my God!
Woo! Welcome to Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling.
This match is out of control. Let's go to the ring.
Welcome once again to Primetime Wrestling. I'm Gorilla Monsoon. I'll be your host for the next 2 hours. And as you can see by our literally empty studio here, Hot Rod and the Weasel are still bickering it out. I doubt very seriously whether either one of them will ever give in to anything. So there's no telling what to expect here next week. But we've got a blockbuster of a lineup for you. All the superstars of the World Wrestling Federation are here. Our feature, of course, Hercules taking on the Big Boss Man. Plenty of other excitement involved. Jake the Snake Roberts will be joining us with some comments and a whole host of others, including King, Hacksaw, Jim Duggan. But right now, we're going to open it with an unbelievable tag team combination, the Bushwhackers. So let's go to ringside.
Everyone here in Fresno starts to bushwhack. As here they come, Luke and Butch, the Bushwhackers. And the fans really love them here in Fresno, Alfred.
They certainly do. And we love them too. These two men have really established themselves as one of the most outstanding tag team combinations ever to wrestle within the ranks of the World Wrestling Federation. Look at him. Who is that?
Maybe a cousin or a nephew. All right, the opponents, the Black Knight and Daryl Nichols. As the Bushwhackers come in, apparently they have no rhyme nor reason about what they're doing, but when the bell rings, there certainly is a good rhyme and reason to what they do in the ring.
Yes, there is. They are unpredictable. They do the unexpected at most incredible times. But really, I look a little deeper into these two men. They are very, very clever indeed. They have absolutely befuddled all their opponents with the way they wrestle, but you know, they do combine their talents very, very well.
And now, right on the head, here we go. It's going to be Butch going up against the Black Knight. The connoisseurs of sardines.
Oh, gosh.
Do you know sardines help lower the cholesterol?
Do they? Really?
Yes.
In that case, I should have some.
So they're a healthy group. Here they go now. The Knight goes in and a big clothesline. Now into the corner, the big fist coming from Butch. He hits the ropes on the left side, and once again, he stays right on his man. Look at him, Alfred, going right over to pick him up and helping the masked man right up to his feet.
Yes, once they get on top, and they're very seldom in any other situation anyway, the Bushwhackers stay on top. And they make very, very good tag team changes. Their tag team work is absolutely excellent. They would have you believe that all of those things are accidental, but they're not.
Not at all, calling out to the fans. Is that the good-looking one of the group? Luke? With a front face lock. And he goes right back to a corner for Daryl Nichols to get in. A lot of things going on in the World Wrestling Federation in the tag team wars, and you have to look at the great tag teams. There's a big headbutt getting out of the corner. One of them, the Powers of Pain along with Mr. Fuji, casting an eye toward the Bushwhackers, and what a matchup that could be.
Indeed it could. Daryl Nichols is a big, tough, strong wrestler, but he's taking some punishment already in this match, Tony.
Double team here, and the man on the outside is the man with the hat. And there is Butch in with a fist and sending the man down once again. The Bushwhackers remain on the offense of one of those high-impact maneuvers. And there goes Nichols again, this time to a neutral cutter. Here comes Butch off with a stomp right on the back of the neck. And look at this, springing out the ropes again. A lot of quickness shown right there, Alfred. And he's staying right on his opponent.
Yes, making this combination of Nichols and the Black Knight look absolutely ineffective inside the ring. And that's not the case, in fact. Nichols is a very good wrestler on his own. He's good as a tag team with the Black Knight, but look at them. They've had no chance whatsoever against the Bushwhackers.
Relentless right now is Luke holding the ropes and getting a warning from the referee, calling out to the fans once again. And Nickel basically at his mercy. Here's a tag, and here comes Butch once again. The Bushwhackers stomping, kicking, pounding their way, apparently towards another win. It seems right here because they are not having much of a contest from their opponents here. Let's see if they can keep it up, though. Keep the intensity on and a big elbow, apparently so.
And there's a lot of reluctance on the part of the Black Knight to tag in as well. He's not really making a full effort there to get his partner to some sort of safety. Obviously, he doesn't want to come back into the ring against the Bushwhackers.
And now holding the chin, the chest, and the big headbutt. Well, Luke likes to use that head, doesn't he? And you can tell he's used it a lot. And there's a poke right to the eyes. And Nickel not knowing what corner he's in. Here comes another great double team right to the midsection. And Luke is on the outside again.
Effectively cutting the ring in half. The Bushwhackers, oh, beautiful move there by Butch. He caught his man very close to the ropes, allowing him no escape at all. Consequently, Darryl Nichols went in, and the battering ram.
The battering ram, you're right, Alfred. A great double team move from the Bushwhackers, and now setting up Nickel for the high knee. Left, down he goes. It's Luke with the cover. And it's the Bushwhackers with another win. A tremendous win. Let's get the official word.
Here are your winners, the Bushwhackers.
A lot of Bushwhacker fans out in the audience here at Fresno. And look at them, elated over another win from those two.
They love the Bushwhackers. Look at them. Hats coming off at the right angle. Everything else. Even the little ones can do the Bushwhacker belts. A tremendous victory there for the Bushwhackers. Most impressive. What a great combination they are. Luke and Butch. Victorious again. The Bushwhackers.
Bushwhackers proving why they are one of the most unpredictable and unbeatable teams here in the World Wrestling Federation. But in my 28 years tenure here in the World Wrestling Federation, I have never seen such a gathering of specialties and tag team action here in the WWE. Unbelievable. Everybody looking for the gold. Everybody looking for what will bring the wealth to them, put the cash in their pocket. Everyone in the world still buzzing about what happened when history was made in the Meadowlands at SummerSlam, and once again, the Ultimate Warrior regained his Intercontinental Championship belt, taken away by ravishing Rick Rude, but this feud is a long way from being over because these two guys have a vendetta which was not ended in SummerSlam by a long shot. So there's going to be plenty of ramifications, and Mean Gene Okerlund is standing by to bring us up to date on the whole situation. Here's Mean Gene.
From the pages of the World Wrestling Federation magazine, here's update.
All right, folks, big news this Monday night at the Meadowlands in SummerSlam. A brand new Intercontinental Champion is crowned, and he is the Ultimate Warrior. Big surprise, making a guest appearance Monday night in SummerSlam, none other than Rowdy Roddy Piper. Let's go to the footage.
The fans right after Bobby the Brain Heenan. As his man, ravishing Rick Rude, tries to take command of this match.
And Rude's going up the ropes.
He's going to try just a high-risk maneuver right here. As he's up. Down he goes.
Foot in there.
The fans are going bananas here. The cover.
What's going? What the heck?
It's Rowdy Roddy Piper.
What is Piper doing here?
Rowdy Roddy Piper!
What business is this of Roddy Piper being down here?
Jeff, you see what's gone down between Piper and ravishing Rick Rude.
Pile driver by Rude, he's gonna get him.
One, two.
Oh, come on, Marella. Count him.
Everything that Rick Rude can give the Warrior's taken. And now.
What is the purpose for Roddy Piper being here?
There's been a lot of animosity between Piper and Ravishing Rick Rude. We've seen it on primetime.
And look at Rude giving it to him. Look at Rude giving it to him.
And Piper gave it right back.
After Rowdy Roddy Piper appeared on the scene, Ravishing Rick Rude couldn't concentrate on his match with the Ultimate Warrior. Let's see what happened.
Roddy Piper caused this whole thing. Rude had this match won.
I don't know if he had it won or not. He certainly had the advantage, and now the advantage is all Ultimate Warriors.
This is horrible. This is an atrocity. I can't believe Morella would allow Piper to come out here and distract the champion.
High over his head. Drops him down. The Warriors. Rolls him over. Yes. Let's get the official word.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner.
Look at the fans, as the promise has come true. The Ultimate Warrior is the champion.
Yeah, he's the champion, or he better run right out. Thank Rowdy Roddy Piper, because Piper's the one that caused Rude to lose.
Okay.
Roddy Piper.
And a celebration somewhere here in the Meadowlands among a thousand of fans jammed in.
On the heels of that melee last Monday night in SummerSlam, we got comments from Ravishing Rick Rude and manager Bobby the Brain Heenan.
Never, never.
Wait a minute, Bobby. Warrior, I told you, you weren't man enough to beat me one-on-one. And I proved it to the world. I had you beat. There was no way you could become the champion. Then what happened? What happened, Bobby?
Where did Piper come from? He was supposed to be at home.
We were jobbed. They planned all this. They stuck it to us. The World Wrestling Federation, the Ultimate Warrior, and you, Rowdy Roddy Piper. Well, we're going to stick it back. You're going to wish you stayed home, Piper. You're going to wish you never came to SummerSlam.
Well, as I stated, this went a long way from being over. Obviously, Ravishing Rick, very upset with a hot rod, and you saw what the Brain was doing. When things don't go his way, he just breaks down, and he's a useless individual. And that happens quite a bit with Bobby the Brain Heenan or the Weasel. I don't want to upset him too much. Two guys you really love to hate are coming up right now, the Rougeau, Jacques and Raymond.
This tag team contest is scheduled for...
We're going to be part of tag team greatness here, I'm sure, because we've seen nothing but greatness from these two men, along with their manager coming into the ring, Jack and Raymond, the Rougeaus. That man continually talks, and here they come, waving the American flags. And Alfred, this is a great tag team, no question about it. And it's hard to believe that they're getting better and better, but apparently, each and every time we see them, we see something better.
Absolutely, they are so good. Jacques and Raymond,
Jim Evans.
They have absolutely taken over the ranks of tag team wrestling here in the World Wrestling Federation. And very, very few teams have had much success against them. So the youngsters here, Jim Evans and his partner, they're really facing an uphill battle.
Evans trying to get on to Jacques Rougeau, but Jacques gets away and then does a little nip-up force. Success in the form of the Rougeaus, but standing by another successful team. Let's hear from the Rockets.
SummerSlam is over, Rougeau brothers, but the war rages on. The summer is not complete until the Rockers get rid of you once and for all.
That's right, and you know up to now our style's been high-flying, bouncing around the ring, something you wouldn't know anything about. But now we're gonna show you nothing but fists and elbows and knees. As Rougeaus, we got one thing in mind, finish you off.
Woo! Very determined youngsters right there, Alfred.
They are most determined. They're an electric combination. The Rockers, they've done exceptionally well for themselves. And what a match that would be, the Rougeaus against the Rockers.
Look at this, great double team from Evans and Bertruck. Sending Jacques Rougeau in, he ducks the double clothesline, and a double drop kick. Oh, nice elevation that time, and great body control out.
Oh, tremendous move there by Jacques Rougeau. And he looks as if he's going to finish this combination off by himself. He's not even going to let his brother go. Get a look at him with that beastly infernal instrument there.
Flying elbow. Jacques Rougeau really showing us something that he can really turn it on when need be. Sending Bertruck down, clipping Jim Evans in the corner, taunting at Evans, allowing Evans to come in, and that's going to allow the double team on the other side. Here's Raymond in. Oh, with a great slack kick. And he nailed him, put him right down to the center of the ring.
What a great kick that was by Raymond. Right flush on the jaw of Jan Bertruck. And now he's obviously feeling very, very bad. His best thing is to try and make that tag to his partner, Jim Evans, on the outside, if he can. But these two youngsters are really being put to the test here.
Great vertical suplex. And you know, Alfred, when you take a look at the situation that has developed and has been going on between the Rockers and the Rougeaus, there's no question, because of the ability of both teams, that it has the potential for a tremendous match. But I would assume that match would turn into nothing less than a brawl because of the animosity between the teams.
I'm sure of that. That is uppermost in their minds, to finish each other off. They wouldn't be going straight out for a victory, I know that. But at the same time, both teams are so skillful. They have so much in the way of wrestling talent. Oh, look at that jab from the outside. Referee, of course, unsighted. That it would, in any case, be a really tremendous struggle.
Here's Jacques Rougeau with the knees down on the back of Bertruck. Turns him over, apparently has him now for the two and the three with a little muscle pose right there. No question the class of this. And let's get the word on it.
Here are your winners, the fabulous Rougeau brothers.
Well, Alfred, once again, let's take a look.
Yes, a little while ago, this is what we saw, where Jacques nailed both those men with one drop kick, and he finished the two of them off practically at the same time. And there, of course, was that tremendous knee drop. Look at the Rougeau brothers. With the mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, their catalysts for success, a victorious combination, the Rougeau brothers.
Rougeau is another example of the caliber of talent here in the World Wrestling Federation, tag team talent, that is. These two guys are a couple of hypocrites in my book from Montreal, and a lot of people ask me, they get confused, they can't tell Raymond from Jacques, and it's really quite simple. Jacques is the fat one. So remember that, so the next time you watch him, you'll know. Stay with us, coming up, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. King Hacksaw Jim Duggan, what a proud American this individual is, and what a proud person to be carrying around that cape and that crown. Well, represents the World Wrestling Federation. And his opponent this week here on Primetime Wrestling, former Steve Lombardi, referring to the Brooklyn Brawler. Here it is.
The following contest is scheduled
for, I don't think there's any question, Lord Alfred Hayes, that this event is going to be a brawl.
The Brooklyn Brawler. And his opponent, soon to be entering the ring.
The fans here in Springfield, Massachusetts, rise to their feet, and here comes King Duggan.
King Duggan!
Yeah, that's what I said. King Duggan!
Yes. In all his majesty, Tony, look at him. He's got everything. Proudly carries the flag, wears the crown, holds the 2x4, his symbol of the common working man. He is a wonderful, wonderful, charismatic person.
And now he's up on the apron of the ring. Everyone has a good time when King Duggan steps in the ring, with the exception of the opponent, of course. Thumbs up for the fans here.
At the outset, Tony, you were talking about the brawler being in there to brawl, and that's all he knows. And if he chooses to go that way, which he obviously will do, he's going to have a fight on his hands with this man, King Duggan, because he can indeed brawl as well.
Some Hacksaw fans in the gathering here in Springfield. Boy, they really respond to that thumb in the air and the shout of King Duggan. He's going to start the fans to clap, and the brawler is not appreciative of this at all. He wants to get right at it.
Oh, look at Duggan. Chase the brawler around there.
Get him back. No, 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 no.
talking. He's something else, isn't he? Look at him now. These people, they just rise to him. He only has to look at them. They're up on their feet, yahooing or whatever that noise is that he makes. And the brawler doesn't like that at all. You're absolutely right, Tony.
I don't think I've seen anyone stick their tongue out at the referee like that. Here's a forearm shot into the ropes. A duck this time to the brawler, but he caught him, did King Duggan, with a big clothesline. And once again, King Duggan exploding out of the corner and down onto the floor goes the Brooklyn Brawler. We've made mention of this before, Alfred, but it needs to be talked about again. And that is, Duggan has the uncanny ability to turn his attention away from his opponent, but still be into the match.
Yes, he really does. He manages to ignore them, you might say, and he's sort of oblivious to them, but suddenly he can swing that whole thing around and take over again. And here, quite honestly, the brawler's had no look into this match whatsoever. He's had no offensive moves. His best place, quite honestly, at the moment, is outside. No, he's not. He shouldn't be outside. Maybe he's better off inside.
Here comes King Duggan out, but you're right, sending the brawler back in. Duggan looking out towards the fan. The brawler just goes on the other side. Forget this. Oh, he got it. Nice move by the brawler. He caught him as Duggan, maybe a little bit too reckless that time, stuck his head through the ropes on the outside.
Yes, he was a little reckless there. I don't know how to explain that except to say that that was obviously a lack of concentration. He allowed himself to lapse in his concentration for just a little moment there, and the brawler is certainly one to take a quick advantage of that.
The chant of USA as the brawler goes right to the eyes of King Duggan. Duggan holds his ground, reverses the field, but the brawler holds on nicely to the near side ropes with a kick and a quick cover. He gets a two count, and King Duggan's out.
A tremendous kick there by the brawler, and yet Duggan only took a two count. In fact, it was only a 1.5 count before he was out. He's a powerful, powerful man, a big man too, at 6'5", 280 pounds. And the brawler, well, he's kind of holding his own now, but in the opening moments of this match, he was certainly on the receiving end of a lot of punishment.
All right, head first to a turnbuckle. That's not bothering King Duggan at all. He blocks two of those and comes with an elbow of his own, and now the brawler finds his head first to a neutral corner. Here we go to the other side again. The king is in. He missed, did King Duggan. And the brawler falls up with a snapmare. Here's a cover, got the leg hooked, but Duggan was right out of it.
Tony, this is all typical wrestling maneuvers by King Duggan, because what he does is he puts his whole heart into everything. He rushes into everything, he doesn't care. And eventually he connects and he beats his man in that fashion. I've never seen him yet where he hasn't taken a lot of punishment in a bout and yet somehow or other come out on top at the end.
Into the midsection. A second time for King Duggan by the hair. The brawler takes Duggan down, right back to the mat, but the referee was not there to see that one. With the fans letting him know what happened, however, nothing he can do.
If brawler believes that he's wearing King Duggan down with this perpetual neck and headlock that he's holding on Duggan, I think he should start having another little thought to himself and reassess his tactics, because that's going to do nothing to Duggan.
All right, right hands. But the brawler rakes at the eyes, and Duggan staggers all the way over to the other corner. Here comes the brawler again. Clothesline just actually pushed him down that time.
Yes, Alfred. It was more of a push than a clothesline. I don't think that hurt Duggan, and it didn't, because Duggan was very quickly out of the way of that elbow drop.
You read that one right, and misses with the double axe handle, and now King Duggan unloading on a helpless Brooklyn brawler right now. Look at this, Duggan crawling the turnbuckles and pounding away on the side of the head.
And right now, the brawler has taken a lot of punishment. He's beginning to run out of gas now, and he's looking very sluggish. And I would imagine that he's terribly close to being defeated. Look at this.
The cover and the kick out.
Duggan's telling our referee here, Dave Hebner, be a little quicker with that count. A switch there in the tactics for Duggan. You don't often see him in a static position like that with a headlock, and he's decided to give that one up anyway. That is not Duggan.
For a man his size, King Duggan certainly has a lot of reserve and seems to move around that ring quite well, and for a lengthy period of time.
Incredible energy he has all the time. He doesn't only have unending charisma, he has energy in excelsis. Little intelligence there.
22 his noggin. And a hacksaw, King Duggan.
And Brawler has really felt the brunt of the attack that's been waged upon him by that fantastic fellow there.
Fans still right with him, although it's apparent King Duggan has really kicked it, so to speak, into high gear right now. He is after the Brawler on the outside. And now over near the rail. Watch out.
Gosh. Head first into that rail, the Brawler. I really do believe the Brawler's very, very close to almost expiring, you might say.
We'll see. Can Hacksaw end it up right here? Picks him up nicely. Showing the power. Slamming the Brawler down. And now getting into that neutral corner. He'll wait on the Brawler. We've seen it before to arise. And he'll explode out of the three-point stance with a big clothesline. That's his move. There's his cover. And there is your three count. It's all King Duggan in Springfield. And here's the official word. Well, Alfred, there was no question this man was on top of his game, so to speak. And with a 2x4, he gets to win once again.
Yes, His Majesty controlled that belt right from the outset. And it was really a tremendous victory for him because the Brawler hardly figured in it. I'd like to see, once again, exactly how I disposed of the Brooklyn Brawler. Here he goes down into that three-point stance. The Brawler really doesn't know what's going to happen here. And here he comes. Watch this explosive clothesline. Boom! Down goes the Brawler, flat out. He couldn't possibly raise anything in there. Referee quickly in for 1, 2, 3. And as I said before, a majestic figure. The charismatic King Duggan, a victor again.
King Hacksaw Jim Duggan looking good this week here on Primetime Wrestling. Notice the Brooklyn Brawler. You didn't see Bobby Heenan anywhere in sight, did you? Once he takes a guy, he's got every dime he can get out of him, immediately dumps him like yesterday's garbage. Well, that's what happened to the poor Brooklyn Brawler. This guy's got nothing to look forward to now. Dino Bravo will be coming up in mere moments. Dino Bravo, 10 times more dangerous right now since the takeover of the Colonel, the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, since now under his tutelage, this guy is real trouble. Here's a guy that's probably one of the strongest men in the world today. Now you team him up with a vicious person like the Colonel, and big trouble is in store for anyone. Right now, let's take a look at the big Canadian strongman.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Currently in the ring, weighing in at 240 pounds and hailing from San Pedro, California, here is Louis Spicoli.
Yeah, Alfred, I tell you, Louis Spicoli right now with a confident smile on his face. But when he sees this massive man walk to the ring, that's probably going to change. Now, I wasn't talking about beautiful Mike McGurk. I was talking about this massive man right here, Dino Bravo.
Here is Canada's strongest man.
And look at that look.
Dino Bravo.
And what heights his career has reached now that he's taken the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, as his manager. What a shrewd move that was by Bravo. And he is a powerful man indeed, possessor of that debatable world bench press record. Some people say he was assisted by Jesse Ventura in achieving that, but in any case, he did lift some tremendous weights there.
You were talking about Colonel Jimmy Hart, or the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. One thing we can say about Jimmy Hart, and that is he keeps a great attitude for his men at ringside. Always keeps them pumped up, always talks to them in a very confident tone, and that has helped Dino Bravo.
It has indeed. And also he instills into his men that necessary piece of their armor, a killer spirit. Look, he loves it. He loves it. He does, because that's what he's told Bravo. Oh, nearly took Spicoli's head right off.
I would think after that blow, Dino Bravo can do just about anything he wants to do.
I would imagine definitely. Spicoli is a tough youngster, though, and he does have that necessary ingredient, youth, that I'm afraid I don't have anymore. But it is a necessary thing in the ring.
Oh, gosh. Tremendous belly-to-back suplex. Bravo having his way with Spicoli. He pulls the youngster up.
Well, he's obviously going to use Spicoli from now on as a punching bag almost for a workout, because he actually had him pinned easily there and could have finished him off.
High vertical suplex. Bravo picks him up again.
And if you notice there, Tony, his balance was absolutely perfect with that high pause-type suplex. So he is using this, obviously, to show everybody else who's watching at the moment just how good he is, and that's a good thing to do.
And I guess the mouth of the South wants the count out and the easy way out, but that apparently is not what Dino Bravo wants. Oh, big forearm sledgehammer right across the chest. And here we go again, back inside. Here comes maybe, yes, the side suplex.
Oh, gosh. He does it so masterfully, Dino Bravo. Of course, as you said, Tony, he nearly knocked his man out in the beginning with that tremendous clothesline. And that side dump. Ah, what a move that is.
When you're in with Dino Bravo, you better believe you're in for a big fight. And let's get the official word.
Canada's strongest man, Dino Bravo.
Fans don't appreciate how he won the match, but he did win it.
He did indeed. Spicoli, I'm sure, will have better days in the ring, but here was a black day for him because Dino Bravo was at the peak of his form. Look at that beautiful side move there. Pins his man, and well, there was that vertical suplex. A tremendous victory for that great French-Canadian, Dino Bravo.
As we stated earlier on, Dino Bravo, very powerful, very dangerous individual. I don't know, it may be in the works. The Colonel may be working something out with a Slickster, and perhaps down the road somewhere, we'll see Dino Bravo teaming up with Rick Martel. What a combination that would be. You've got everything you want there, power, agility. They could have it all. But right now, here's a guy that's got it all, Sean Mooney in the WWF Event Center.
Hello, everybody. I'm Sean Mooney. Many wonder just where a superstar acquires his wrestling ability. Now, many acquire their skill in the amateur ranks, while other superstars have used different methods to acquire the skill needed to be a superstar here in the World Wrestling Federation. One such individual is Bad News Brown. His training grounds, the streets of Harlem.
Let me give you spineless cockroaches and you beer-belly sharecroppers a little lesson in history. After the WrestleMania 4, it's the first time you people ever saw me, and they saw what I can do. They saw the devastation that I brought to those spineless cockroaches there. The gate went down. That's right, the gate went down. That pompous windbag, the president of the WWF, Jack Tunney, has done everything in his power to keep me from getting a championship match. That's right. First it was on that Randy Macho Man Savage. He did everything to protect him. He put Elizabeth in front of him. And now he's got this Hollywood Hogan who thinks he's a big-time Hollywood movie star. He's got the belt, and he don't want to get into the ring with Bad News Brown because he knows I show no mercy and I take no prisoners.
Well, Bad News Brown, a man who keeps to himself, no manager, no friends. But who can argue, thus far, it has proved to be a successful formula for the man from Harlem. Another man on the road to success is Tito Santana, but he is well aware there are some obstacles in his path.
You know, all of a sudden, Rick Martel, you're running around with a good bunch of people, huh? A bunch of losers, as far as I'm concerned. You know, the likes of Greg the Hammer Valentine, Haku, the Weasel, everybody's giving you all kinds of advice not to worry about Tito Santana, because by the time Tito Santana gets to you, he will not be able to compete. Making promises that they're gonna hurt you for me. Well, let me tell you something. Everybody wants to hurt Tito Santana, but I've got one guy in mind that's where my heart hurts. The guy that makes me hurt deep down inside is you, Rick Martel, and no one is gonna keep me from getting to you. I've got some tough matches coming up, brother, but you're the number one man that I'm after. Arriba!
Well, Tito Santana, the best friend a man could ever have, that is until you cross him. He is certainly one of the top contenders here in the World Wrestling Federation, and he is set to take on all challengers. But number one on his list is Rick Martel. The action continues right after this.
Right to the hand. Hammerlock showing some great agility here. Mark Young showing some also with a standing dropkick. And down goes the genius.
You know, folks, every week I get an opportunity to talk to a lot of people all over these United States, and most of them ask me a lot of questions. And one of the questions popping up most frequently of late is, who is this guy, the genius? Where did he come from? Where is he going? Well, personally, I don't care where he came from, and I can think of about a half a dozen places I'd like to send him. But the guy has ability, has talent. Where he got his credentials to be a genius, that remains to be seen. But this week, here on Primetime, we're going to take a look at him in the ring.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. Currently in the ring, weighing in at 228 pounds and hailing from Atlanta, Georgia, here is Mark Young.
There he is, Mark Young. And we've seen some great things out of this youngster from Atlanta.
About to be entering the ring. Weighing in at 252 pounds and hailing from Downers Grove, Illinois.
Oh, no.
Here is the genius.
I don't like to make opinions, but I can't say anything good about this guy.
Well, he does have tremendous wrestling skills, Tony, you've got to say that. But he's become a little too boastful for my liking recently. And quite honestly, those words of wisdom that he spouts
are too wise. Every William Shakespeare sonnet has 10 syllables a line. And some of them are pretty good, but not as good as mine. He hides behind his these and thous, relying on his name. I know his verses A to Z, and some are pretty lame.
Yeah.
Take Henry Wadsworth Longfellow and
lame.
Edgar Allan Poe. They've had a couple winners, but they mostly place and show. Robert Service is more like it, and so is Edgar Guest. But if they were alive today, they'd all call me the best. Ogden Nash has diaper rash, and Frost just leaves me cold. And why are all these poets dead, and I'm not even old? The proof is right between my ears, and now you must believe. You're looking at the smartest man since Adam courted Eve.
That's not bad, is it, Tony?
You liked that, didn't you, Al?
Yes, I did. I thought that had a touch of humor to it. There was a little rhythm to it, some syncopation, and it wasn't bad at all. Now let's see what he can do against Mark Young, who is definitely one of the better of a new crop of young wrestlers in the World Wrestling Federation, and Mark Young has quite an enviable record for a youngster coming into a very, very tough man's career.
The bell has sounded, and I don't know why Young just doesn't just go right to the corner and nail him one time. Well, I mean, I'm not trying to be a coach here, but for goodness sakes, the genius loves to take his own time, dictate the pace, and kind of be prissy around the ring, and you could just knock that right out of him, you would think.
Yes, I think sooner or later, Mark Young will become a battle-bitter veteran of ring wars, and he won't allow chances like that to slip by him so easily.
Mark Young waiting, being very patient on the genius now. Young, you're right, a tremendous athlete, and the genius, even though he has a lot of things to say, and we don't like him, at least Alf, I do, I don't. Alfred does. Someone here doesn't.
Come on now. I saw you smile at some of those little witticisms of his, you know, Frost leaving him cold and
Ogden Nash having diaper rash.
Yes.
Yeah. That certainly was a revelation. All right, the genius getting the cat coming back in and still without a blow from Mark Young. Now the collar and elbow tie up to the side headlock. And the genius with a great reversal right to the hammerlock, showing some great agility here. Mark Young showing some also with a standing dropkick. And down goes the genius. Now Young once again staying in the ring. Oh my goodness. He's really excited, isn't he?
Well, that's really super. I love the way he came to his feet after that little street dance or whatever you call it there. Now the genius knows exactly what he's up against. He was on the receiving end of a tremendous drop kick.
Whoa. Oh, my God. Well, I tell you what, Mark Young let himself open for that one. A reversal, Young staying right with the genius. Hip toss, genius tried to hold himself up that time, but still now, Young got him over. With the hand, Mark Young with the wrist lock on. Sending the genius now with the ride into the near side ropes. Deep arm drag, Young again. Mark Young getting poised every time. Notice how he comes up in a great, I guess, attack position after every arm drag.
Yes, very, very good indeed. Very quick, good balance, straight back to his feet after each of those arm drags, and he was more than ready for the assault by that man, the Genius. Good block by the Genius.
It was. Genius pointing right to his noggin that time, and Mark Young flips over the top, and a hip toss again. Mark Young ready for him one more time. Boy, we are really impressed by Mark Young early on. He is staying right with the Genius, even though he has had his chance to take some wide open shots and has declined.
Yes, he has indeed. And as I said at the outset of this, he'll probably forget about that later on and go straight for his man in a more purposeful manner. But his wrestling, my word, it's something to be envied. He has great ability.
The Genius now backed into the corner, and he'll find himself in a tough position here. Right to the midsection. There you go. He didn't get the break that time. Mark Young maybe learning a little bit here just in a few moments of this match. Sending the Genius in. Yeah, went in with reckless abandon that time, Alfred.
He really did. He threw caution to the winds there. He gave him that contemptuous slap around the face, a retaliatory move. But the Genius was even more to the match for Mark Young than he supposed he would be, because he really nailed him with that boot as he came into the corner.
A kick to the side of the head. Mark Young explodes out with an elbow and a headbutt from the Genius.
That surprised me, that move by the Genius. I've never seen him do that before.
The Genius collars Young. Great vertical suplex. Great execution. Even though he does prance around the ring, you've got to realize, oh, missed the execution point on that one.
He did indeed. I believe that's what he calls his honor roll, although he usually perfects that from the top rope. But having missed that, now he's on the receiving end of three slams. Tremendous stuff by Mark Young.
Mark Young got the knee kind of low that time, right in the abdomen. He misses the big right hand. Here's the roll-up. Great variation of a sunset flip, and that is it. Boy, the Genius had him laid out perfectly that time.
Here is your winner, the Genius.
Well, I tell you what, Alfred, for all his prancing and dancing and talk, it was a very, very impressive win for the Genius.
It was indeed, and I really like the way he pulled that off at the end there. That was a really nice move, one that I haven't seen before. Watch this very, very closely. Jumps up like that in a sort of a piggyback position, rolls him back, and has those two shoulders beautifully pinned. A great move there by the Genius. And unfortunately for Mark Young, he didn't have an answer for that one. Good, good victory, but a good showing and an impressive showing by Mark Young.
Obvious to everyone, the Genius certainly has wrestling ability and wrestling credentials. And notice his poetry didn't help him a bit in the ring. He used all his natural ability to get the victory. You know, not too long ago, right here on Primetime Wrestling, we ran a big contest called the Sing-A-Song Showdown. Involved were, of course, the Honky Tonk Man under the tutelage of the Colonel, and this individual we're going to take a look at right now, Dusty the American Dream Rhodes. Incidentally, no one won the contest. Here's Mean Gene.
Ladies and gentlemen, have I got a treat for you. This man is America, Dusty Rhodes.
Listen to the response for Dusty Rhodes as we hear the music, and look at this man.
Oh, he's got the hat, he's got the handcuffs, he's got the club, and all of that at one time belonged to the big boss man.
And he's got the polka dots.
Oh, I love it.
Dusty, very, very good. So many things happening. You've got to be excitement personified.
I'm out here to talk about one big, bad boss man. And that melon farmer slick, the word on the street from the brothers is, Dusty Rhodes is to be tried. He is to face litigation. He is to be interrogated in public. Woo! My brand of Americana justice is everywhere in this building. It is Americana justice. You have been tried.
sentence, and I will give out the execution, if you will, Daddy. Look what I got here.
I remember.
He was forcefully, I'm talking about forcefully, interrogating individuals. So, if I catch you in any arena, in any street, in any building, in any back alley, in any ballroom, in any dance hall, interrogating American public, I will interrogate you, baby.
You gotta be talking about the former corrections officer from Cobb County, Georgia, the big boss man.
Now, you are not my boss. And you sure are nobody else's boss. And when I'm through with you, you're not gonna be much of a man, baby. Woo! Yeah!
Judge and jury!
Yes, a very competent Dusty Rhodes. And to go up against the big boss man, to go right after the big boss man,
he's just
and take the nightstick in the and the cuffs.
He's trying to get Mean Gene here to get down. Oh, yeah.
They're having a great time in Fresno with the World Wrestling Federation. And we'll have a great time when we come back.
Americana, Dusty Rhodes getting it down and getting dirty with Mean Gene, but he'll have to do better when he faces, of course, his biggest nemesis right now, the big boss man. That's going to be an interesting confrontation when it comes down to Pike. Another individual coming down to Pike doing big things here in the World Wrestling Federation will join us when we come right back, and that is Brutus the Barber Beefcake. One of the hot items right now here in the World Wrestling Federation is a gentleman called Brutus the Barber Beefcake. This guy loves to give everyone a trimming. And if you stand in his way, there are no exceptions. Sooner or later, he's going to get to you, as Scary Sherry found out, didn't she? If you were in the Meadowlands or you were a member who partook of SummerSlam, you saw that and you know what I'm talking about. This individual is not only an outstanding wrestler, but an outstanding individual. Everyone wants to be close to him, get near to him. Longtime personal friend of the WWF champ, the Hulkster. So let's take a look at Brudai.
Some great things have happened here at the Oakland Coliseum, and here's one of them right here. The appearance and the entrance of Brutus the Barber Beefcake. And he basically is on his home turf here. The San Francisco native coming in, the Barber, and there's his fans watching on. And he's going up in this event against Chuck Campbell. The Barber, as the thousands of fans jam-packed here in the Coliseum, watching on. As a matter of fact, there's another man watching on who has a keen interest in the Barber. His name is Rick Martel, and as the fans show the signs of the Clippers, and Brutus responds, as a matter of fact, the man standing by is Rick Martel with some comments, and I think we ought to listen to what he has to say.
Beefcake, everybody thinks you're so cool the way you look, wrestle, and strut. I rate you a 4. Myself, the way I look, wrestle, and dance, I'm a solid 10 because I'm the best there is.
Now, Lord Alfred Hayes, that's not quite fair.
Well, I tell you something, many people will decry those statements by him, but to me, it does register very, very impressively indeed, because he's very confident, he is very cocky, and when you get a man who can back all that up with tremendous ability, as he can, Martel, then you're talking about somebody who can make a tremendous impression. And Brutus Beefcake, I think, should be very, very wary of getting into a match against him.
I don't think there's any question, and I don't think there's any question that if Martel says he's a 10, then if there is such a thing as a 10 rating in the World Wrestling Federation, then Martel is very close to that. But I don't think that you can really say that Brutus is 6 notches below Rick Martel.
No, not at all. If Martel is a 10, I would have to say that Brutus is a 10 as well.
because they are so evenly matched in their talents, their skills, their dedication to wrestling, the way they work out. These men are just tremendous athletes. Any sport in the world would be proud to have two such men in their ranks.
And it apparent from the comments we have heard from Brutus, or especially from Martel, that they are on a collegiate course now, these two fine athletes. And there is a fever about the barber here. He is really at a fever pitch, so to speak, really taking it out on young Chuck Campbell here.
Yes, he is indeed. Well, he knows that Martel is watching this match, as indeed are many, many other wrestlers, of course. But I think he's like trying to send a message to Martel. He doesn't know about the 10 statement, of course, but if he's a 10, he's trying to show Martel that Brutus the Barber is also a 10.
The barber with a determined look on his face going to get Campbell. Look at that wild look on his face. The eyes popped out of the head there. Sends him in now. Here it is, the sleeper hold on Chuck Campbell. And basically, when that's slapped on, if you're not near the ropes, you're just about a gun.
Absolutely, and in this match, Campbell hasn't had much of a chance against a Brutus Beefcake, who is completely on top of his form. And the hand goes down for the third time there. He's out, finished, fast asleep, and a tremendous victory there. Let us get the official word on it.
Here is your winner, Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
Well, the barber contemplating the clipper time here, and I know all the fans, as you can see, want that to happen. Well, is he going to leave Albert, or is he going to do his handiwork?
Oh, I hope not. I really enjoy him doing a little tonsorial work on his beaten opponents. Well, those little scissors that he brings, those very, very sharp scissors that have taken their locks, taken locks off many, many fallen wrestlers. Chuck Campbell's going to be in exalted company here.
And there's a man out there that we heard from earlier, Rick Martel, who is very proud of his looks. And believe you me, in this situation, the barber could change his looks drastically in a few seconds.
Yes, he can indeed. There's a nice little bit of style work down there. I don't think Joey Morella needs any hair cutting.
No, not at all. But Chuck Campbell is still out, and he'll wake up with a brand new hairdo. And your winner is Brutus the Barber Beefcake, and I know, looming in the background, Rick Martel. Time to wake up and see what's happening.
Yes, Martel must have thoughts about this man, Brutus the Barber Beefcake. He was most impressive here today, as he always is, holding those emblematic shears just there. Tremendous victory by Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
What a handful Brutus the Barber Beefcake can be when he gets it wound up, as he was obvious to everyone here this week on Primetime Wrestling. He really looks sensational. Talk about guys that look sensational. Here's a guy that never sees the light of day. He's always trapped in the World Wrestling Federation Event Center, referring to Sean Mooney. Take a good look at him. He never has any tan or anything.
Well, as you are well aware, there are new tag team champions here in the World Wrestling Federation. They are Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard, the Brainbusters. They captured the title from Axe and Smash of Demolition, the former champions, and it is now the Brainbusters who must face the onslaught of challengers. That includes the awesome force of the Rockers, Shawn Michaels and Marty Jannetty.
You know, it's back to old times, rocking and rolling, strutting and strolling, taking care of business, and having good times. And the Rockers have got only one thing on their mind, and of course, that's reaching the top of the World Wrestling Federation, the Tag Team Champions, which is now the Brainbusters, Tully and Arn. But you know, before we worry about them, we got something else we got to take care of, and that's called the Rougeau Brothers, a temporary setback. I tell you what, the WWE has been taking the Rockers from border to border, coast to coast, and we've been having good times, but I'll tell you what, it's time to focus on one thing, and that's the fabulous Rougeau Brothers. You know, we got a little unfinished business, Rougeau Brothers. You did a job on the Rockers, and you thought it was all over. Well, I'll tell you what, these two guys right here are just a little too dumb to just lay down and play dead. We're getting right back up, and we're coming after you, Rougeau Brothers, and when we catch you somewhere, we're going to take care of you once and for all. Woo!
Well, certainly on the minds of the Rockers, take care of the fabulous Rougeau Brothers. They plan to trample Jacques and Raymond on the way to their top of tag team competition here in the WWE. In singles competition, Greg the Hammer Valentine, he continues to raise temperatures. He's standing by with Jimmy Hart.
You know, when you're talking about wrestling, baby, you're talking about Greg the Hammer Valentine. When you're talking about a man, you're talking about Greg the Hammer Valentine. And when you're talking about the figure four leg lock, you're right, it's Greg the Hammer Valentine.
And when you talk about the WWE, period,
You're talking about Greg the Hammer Valentine, and there's a lot of people around here that'll say just that. A lot of people like Tito Santana, a lot of people like Hulk Hogan. And Ronnie Garvin is another one that's going to find out real soon just what it's like to feel the pain and the pressure of the figure four leg lock. Like all of them, Garvin, you're going to fall down to the wayside because the hammer's going to roll right over the top of you and nail you down.
I think we've always known Greg the Hammer Valentine set to take on any competition. But as of late, rugged Ronnie Garvin has been a thorn in his side. Garvin now reinstated, he is back in the ring. And sooner or later, these two will collide. More action on the way. Don't go anywhere. It's coming at you.
Punched him up, and I don't know why.
What's the accuracy of him here?
Oh! He wanted him up, and he got him up.
He did indeed. And just as I'm saying, watch the...
Hi, everyone, and welcome back to Coliseum Corner. For the past 4 years, Coliseum Home Video has received your cards and your letters with suggestions, comments, and observations about the matches we've put on video cassette. And we're very happy to announce that now available from Coliseum Video for the first time ever, WWF fan favorites. All six matches on this video cassette are matches never before seen and matches you, the fans, have requested. Matches such as Jimmy the Superfly Snuka against the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, the Twin Towers against the Hart Foundation, and a big tag team encounter, Andre the Giant and Ravishing Rick Rude against the Ultimate Warrior and King Duggan. Let's take a look at a portion of WWF fan favorites.
I got some money for you, Snuka. Come on out. Take this money, go buy yourself a bunch of bananas or a crate of coconuts, whatever you island people eat. Go out and do whatever you want. But you don't want to come out here and be embarrassed in front of all these people by the million-dollar champion. And I really don't want to break a sweat.
You think he'll take the money, Alpha?
I don't know. I would be very surprised if he did.
Soon to be in the ring area.
And I think that was the most insulting thing to say anyway.
Million-dollar man trying to buy his way out of a fan favorite match here, one of the matches the fans selected. Jimmy Snuka against the million-dollar man. The offer has been made for the money, and let's see what happens. Is he going to take it? Well, it appears he's thinking about it.
It does look as if he's thinking about it. He's going to take it.
Right hand, and I guess he's not going to take the money after all. Out goes the million-dollar man. I guess he is.
He's got all those $100 notes in his hand.
And now oh my goodness.
Oh, he's giving them away. $100, come this way. Over here, we're too far away. Oh dear.
Oh, there they go. They're gonna have a nice evening on the town after this is over.
And look at the million-dollar man. He's lost a modicum of cash, and he certainly doesn't like that. Well, I mean, it must be a modicum if he's got millions.
This must be, I guess. And the Superfly, the match is underway. So the million-dollar man loses the money, and now may lose a lot more. Superfly still with the robe on, sending the million-dollar man in. Big chop. Ted DiBiase getting out of the ring, away from that man.
And look at Superfly. He hasn't taken his cloak off yet. He's still there with his dressing gown on. And now there's double discomfort there for the million-dollar man, Ted DiBiase. Not only has he lost a couple of $1,000, but he's lost a few shots to the Superfly, Jimmy Snuka.
Jimmy Snuka still in the ring. And you can better believe, I don't think there's any doubt right now that he is prepared to do battle, even more so. As DiBiase tries to take the intimidation route, and that won't work either. And he turns his back on this man. Can you believe that? Right hand to the head. He really must be super confident, the million-dollar man.
Absolutely. Snuka just waited his opportunity there, and he was enjoying that moment when the million-dollar man had his back turned to him before he turned around and whoosh, a tremendous right hand by Snuka.
And he has blocked every blow right there. Right, left, and then the foot. Jimmy Snuka
certainly in the position he wants to be. Wheels him around. And the big atomic drop! Oh! Down to the floor.
Well, the million-dollar man is definitely not faring too well at the moment. He's losing everything. And he's in great danger of possibly losing this belt, too. I noticed that Virgil is staying well away from his boss there.
Yeah, I noticed that also. And now, Jimmy Snuka. Is putting the referee into a neutral corner, and I guess Danny Davis will stay right there.
Well, Danny Davis a little tolerant there because the World Wrestling Federation President Jack Tunney has said a wrestler must never, ever, ever lay his hands on a referee or he'll have to answer to that panel that's headed by Jack Tunney. Well, he did, so Snuka's got to be careful.
Has to be extra careful now because he's on the receiving end of some great blows from that great athlete. The Million Dollar Man, and now Snuka sent to the ropes. No, great reversal, shooting the man in with a great leapfrog. Look at this ability. Oh, a big chop. And down goes the Million Dollar Man. And now here we go. Snuka with a big forearm.
Jimmy Snuka, when he gets rolling, there's none better.
Oh, he's so impressive. He has such a charisma, such a personality. He went to the wrong side of the ring there, though. He wasn't watching. He should have been watching Virgil. But how can you keep your eye on two men efficiently at the same time? And he's in a compromising position now.
He really is.
And he doesn't know it, but the Million Dollar Man is eyeing him from behind. This is where the Million Dollar Man could come right up behind him.
Oh, he saw him just in the nick of time right there, Alfred, and got him. And now it's head first to the apron.
Oh, he took care of that so efficiently, but again comes the Million Dollar Man behind him. You can do it once, you can do it twice maybe, but certainly not three times.
And now on the outside, and this is where the Million Dollar Man can really take charge. Head first, he goes to the official timekeeper table here. And the Million Dollar Man in control now. And it was a situation, I guess, that was perpetrated by Virgil. If you go back to it.
Really? It really was. Virgil wasn't saying or doing anything, but he was in the right place at the right time to make this person, the Superfly, distracted. And that, of course, happened after his leg was pulled by Virgil, when he was in a very, very great situation controlling this match against the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase.
Right hand. We are in La Crosse, Wisconsin, by the way, for this event. And now, the Superfly in trouble. He blocked that, though. Another great block by the Superfly. Watch out, DiBiase may get his head into this turnbuckle. Yes, he does.
Oh, and he went into that turnbuckle with a vengeance. All the weight, all the power behind the body of Superfly was behind that slam into the turnbuckle. The same there. Look at the hair floating around everywhere. That's coming out too. But even so, a great wrestler like DiBiase is not completely perplexed by those moves. He was able to strike back with a little offensive action of his own.
Right to the back of the neck, the Million Dollar Man. Trying to get everything going his way now. Nice knee that time, but it did not pin Snuka, although it almost did.
It certainly did. That was a very, very close three that was delivered by our referee, Danny Davis.
Waiting for Snuka to get up. The Million Dollar Man, double axe handle, right on target. Boy, was that well executed.
Oh, face down into the canvas, Snuka went. I would imagine very, very close to being completely unconscious, but still able to function efficiently and kick out of that. Look at the eyes of Snuka. A lot of intensity there. I believe he's a man who indulges in self-hypnotism, and he says it works for him. These island people do, you know.
Well, fans, I think I can safely say that Fan Favorites is going to be a hit, and there's no doubt it's the first of many more to come. And I know I can speak for the people at Coliseum Home Video when I say keep those cards and letters coming in. For Coliseum Home Video and the World Wrestling Federation, I'm Tony Schiavone, and we'll have more of Primetime Wrestling right after this timeout.
Yeah, Rod. Yeah, I'm here in the studio now. I'm doing the prime time right now, yes. Where are you? Oh, in Los Angeles. With the lawyers. Right. Well, whatever. Do whatever you can. I hope to see you here next week. All right. Bye-bye. That was the Hot Rod wishing he were here this week on Primetime Wrestling and almost assuring me that he definitely will be here next week on Primetime Wrestling. The Weasel, I wouldn't put too much stock in where he is. Let's take a look now at the powers of pain, two humongous individuals.
This tag team contest
when you talk about massive, when you talk about big men in the World Wrestling Federation, look no further than right straight ahead, because there they are, led by the devious one, Mr. Fuji, the barbarian, the warlord. These are tremendous athletic specimens, and here they come.
The powers of pain.
What an awesome combination they are.
Of 530 pounds.
530 combined. Dale Wolf and Tom Stone. These two men make up just about one of those guys.
Well, I don't know. Tom Stone is a very rugged character. He's a little ponderous in the ring, a bit slow with his moves, and probably a bit slow upstairs thinking them out. But even so, he still has a fairly impressive record, whereas Wolf, his partner, is very fast. Executes some really nice moves inside the ring, but this opposition there against the powers of pain. That's the barbarian in the ring there, completely unfazed at all by those moves.
Tremendous knee, and look at the authority in those blows. That backhand chop from the barbarian. Looming in the background, no doubt. We've heard talk now, and I'm sure we're going to see it. We want to see it very soon. The Bushwhackers against the powers of pain, and what a conversation that will be. Basically, there's a difference in size, Alfred, but really not that much difference in style.
No, not at all. Both are very battling, bruising type teams.
Look at this. A lot of quickness, too.
Yeah, oh, tremendous quickness. Now, this man in the ring at the moment, the Wall, to me, is the most impressive wrestler and the most awesome wrestler I have ever seen. A possessor of incredible strength. He's 6 feet 6 inches tall, over 300 pounds in weight, and there's not an ounce of fat on that body.
Here is a tag, and here comes Tom Stone. The Warlord got the first blow in. It was a kick. Mr. Fuji very confident, looking ahead for this tag. Right to the boot, and here comes the barbarian. Look at the agility of this big man.
Just a single bound, he was into the ring, taking over the situation from his partner, the Warlord, and barbarian. Gosh, just look at that face.
Big backhand chop from the barbarian.
Good, good, good.
Sending Tom Stone, you heard the reply from ringside from Mr. Fuji in approval. Here's a double axe handle blow, and it's all powers of pain, like it usually is.
Yes, absolutely. You know, the Warlord and the barbarian call Mr. Fuji master, and they're right. He is a master. He's a master of all the tactics that they've taken. So easily, too.
Count this one out. You better believe that. Down goes Tom Stone. Most impressive, and that is an understatement.
Here are your winners, the Powers of Pain.
Well, Alfred, what can you do when you go up against these two?
Well, these are two very, very powerful men. They treated their opposition today with absolute contempt. They weren't in the same class as the Powers of Pain. Here we see one of their devastating team movements, and that was Barbarian who trapped him, and the Warlord came with a dropped elbow. Down goes Tom Stone, and it was the finish of them. Look at them, the Powers of Pain, a magnificent team.
Mr. Fuji getting the Powers of Pain ready, and he doesn't have to get too much ready. These two guys are really a handful contenders for the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team titles. Watch out for these guys. Interesting match coming up right now. Paul Roma taking on the big Russian, Boris Zhukov. What a feather could be in the cap of Paul Roma should he get the win.
Ladies and gentlemen, this contest is scheduled for one fall. Currently in the ring from the Soviet Union, weighing 287 pounds, Boris Zhukov.
Such a pleasant-looking fellow, as always. As we take a look at the thumbs down from the American
ladies and gentlemen, at the request of Mr. Zhukov, he has asked that I ask all of you to rise and respect his singing of the Soviet national anthem.
Союз нерушимый, Республика свободная.
Alfred, he's getting better at it.
I don't know what to agree with that on the
let us disregard his singing and just look at him as a wrestler, because he's a powerful, brutal wrestler.
And he's going up against a man who's powerful himself and also very, very quick. His name is Paul Roma. And here he is. It's Roma against Zhukov. It's a classic case of speed against power.
Yes. What opposites these two are inside the ring. What extreme ends of the scales that we're going to go here. One has tremendous finesse, fantastic wrestling moves, and blistering speed, that of course being Paul Roma. And the other is a ponderous bear-type man, like a rhinoceros. His resolve in the ring is without question very, very intense indeed. But he's ponderous also, just like a rhinoceros, but he does have that dangerous power.
Yeah, that's right. A rhinoceros, I guess, considered the dangerous, one of the most dangerous animals on Earth.
Yes, indeed, and this is a dangerous animal, too. Look at that huge head.
The colored elbow tie-up, you saw Zhukov showing his power momentarily. Now sending Roma now back to the corner again.
You know, the one thing I like about Roma, and I always look for it, unfortunately, he doesn't always throw it, but he has, I wouldn't say right now, the best drop kick there is in professional wrestling.
Big clothesline, Roma with a quick cover. Oh, he almost got him. Almost got him. That quickly.
And the Russian's staggering there. I think he's hurt physically and mentally. He's surprised at the blistering speed of Roma. And Roma moving very, very quickly indeed. And look at the confidence in Roma.
I don't know. How do you hurt that head? I guess hitting each turnbuckle helps things. Look at this agility. Up on the middle turnbuckle, and he comes off with a big chop right down on the forehead. The big man's going down, and again, Roma showing his stuff with another big chop. But still, the big man will not go down. He's going to go to a third corner here. This has to do it, my goodness. Yes! But he didn't keep him down, Alfred.
No.
That's amazing.
I loved it. He stuck with it, Roma, there. Went to each corner and really hammered on that huge head of the Russian. And the Russian tried hard not to go down. Eventually he did. But it shows what power he has in reserve, because he managed to push up.
The Russian's still dazed, you can tell, though. And he is wobbly, but he is still trying to hold himself up, not going down. Roma puts on the side headlock once again. We've seen Paul Roma really come at the big Russian, as the cliche goes, with both barrels loaded. And the Russian remains on his feet, at least for a few seconds. Rolls him over quickly. Let's see if he has it. Too close to the ropes, Alfred. That saved him.
That was a pity for Roma there, because I think he definitely had him. The big Russian, unfortunately for him, he has no defense. The only thing he knows about wrestling is offense. But when it comes to defense, he's very, very limited. And that's something of, look at the ability and agility of Roma. When it comes to defense, of course, the Russian is lost.
Once again, just grabbing the side headlock, squeezing, pushing. And this time, the Russian falls backwards.
I really don't think the Russian knows exactly where he is in that ring at all. He's lost all orientation. He's lost mental ability to think. And right now, he's being easy meat for young Paul Roma, who's showing us exactly how good he really is.
Something like this has to work on a youngster. He is really hitting with some of his best shots. And still, the big Russian can come up with something like that.
Yes, that can take you by surprise. Roma, a little too overconfident there.
I thought he had it.
Wow, wasn't that close?
And Roma just kicked out in the nick of time. That arm from Tim White was on its way down for a three count.
Yes, he's very quick, Tim White, our referee here. He's got a very, very sharp eye, and he was in very quickly, but of course, it wasn't a complete three count.
The chant of USA rings out here as the big headbutt from the Russian sends Roma through the ropes on the far side and right down to the floor.
And how quickly the complexion of a match can change, because Roma was in full swing just moments ago, in complete control of this match. But a couple of moves by that huge Russian has unsettled Roma. And now the huge Russian is making Roma pay for that mistake he committed just a little while ago.
not only that, Alfred, showing you the power of the Russian, it has not taken the Russian as long to get the advantage on Roma as it did Roma to get the advantage on the Russian. It took him a long time, a lot of great moves, before the Russian would even go down.
Yes, absolutely. But then look at the size of that Russian. 300 pounds of brawn and muscle and not too much brain. I shouldn't say that. I'm
well,
sorry.
That was attributed. We will attribute that to Lord Alfred Hayes.
Thank you. Thank you, Joe.
All right. Now, Zukov sending the man in. He missed a clothesline. Here comes Roma. Great clothesline. Coming out of the left-hand ropes. Paul Roma. He is really fired up now. Begging him off is Zukov, and Roma will not let up. Right hand to the near ropes. Here he goes for the ride. And he goes right to the sternum with that one. With a great arm. He's going to try to suplex this guy. My goodness. Yes! Tremendous from Paul Roma. Here he goes up top. And watch out here. Roma, after the suplex, looking, waiting for the Russian to get up. And a flying body press. The Russian has him over. Two and a... No, did he have it? Oh,
that was so close.
It was not
definitely a two count and not a three. Thank goodness for that. Look, that leaping ability of Roma.
Paul Roma with a power slam. Pulls him and pins him. You're talking about a well-deserved win. Let's get the word. What a tremendous win for Paul Roma. Just seconds ago, we thought it had been reversed on him and he was a loser. But no, it's Paul Roma. Albert, let's take a look again.
Yes, what great tactical powers of recovery by Roma. Here he's showing that fantastic leaping ability. And here is that power slam. A little while ago, he was almost beaten. But now he turned the tables on the big Russian. And Paul Roma, a magnificent winner here. Paul Roma.
Paul Roma using all his expertise and his power. This guy is a real powerhouse, and what a victory for him over the big Russian, Boris Zukov. You know, Sean Mooney is standing by in the World Wrestling Federation Event Center. This guy is chalking up quite a few victories of his own. He's got a couple of feathers in his cap, a couple of more feathers. Maybe he'll fly right out of here. Let's go to Sean.
Well, oftentimes, one superstar's personality will, well, shall we say, clash with another's. Nowhere was the explosion heard louder than when Greg the Hammer Valentine met up with rugged Ronnie Garvin, and we have been feeling the shockwaves ever since. These two cannot wait to meet, and standing by with more is rugged Ronnie Garvin.
Yes, Greg Valentine, I am feeling good, and you're looking at a man that's physically fit to take anybody on. I'm going to tell you, I can swim the deepest river, climb the highest mountains, and everybody that mentions your name, I even intensify when it comes to energy. You see, because I can take you. You made the fatal mistake of your career. You should have forgot about Ronnie Garvin. You should have let me be a referee, because you had me. You see, but my little games worked. It worked on you. It worked on your manager. And now you cannot handle it. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Walk that aisle, step in that ring, and get ready to sweat, get ready to get hurt, and get ready to be physical like you've never been in your life. Because I'm going to tell you, I'll take you right here.
Rugged Ronnie Garvin, after a brief absence as a referee, he has now been reinstated as a wrestler and is back in action in the ring. He has just one thing in his mind, get even with Greg the Hammer Valentine. Right now it's time to hear from a newcomer, but he is no newcomer to the ring. Let's hear from the Widowmaker.
I find it so very humorous that whenever the Widowmaker's name is mentioned, all of the wrestlers around the World Wrestling Federation shiver. Whether they be my opponents or my friends, of which I have very few. Because when they look into my eyes, they know that I mean business. Each and every time that I step into the ring, I step in there with one goal in mind. Winning the match is not always everything, but making sure that my opponent knows he's faced the Widowmaker is. When I step into the ring, I take what I want, and it's always my opponent.
Well, the Widowmaker, he has been on some roll since his arrival here in the World Wrestling Federation, and thus far he has made quite an impression in the ring. But usually that impression is from his opponent's body. Keep your eye on this guy, the Widowmaker, destined to be a big superstar here in the World Wrestling Federation.
We'll see some tremendous moves from this young man.
Big clothesline that missed. Great pinwheel from
Martel.
Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase, very proud of what he did to one individual referred to as Jake the Snake Roberts, sidelining this guy for quite some time. Most serious neck injury, cervical vertebrae area, transverse process breakage. Perhaps he would have been out forever, but that remains to be seen. Standing by with comments right now, the guy who carries around the deadly python, Damien. Here is Jake the Snake Roberts.
I'll be the first one to admit, the Million Dollar Man, he deserves a pat on the back. He's the one that put Jake the Snake Roberts down, and they said he wouldn't come back. Liars, all of them. DiBiase, one thing about a man like me, when you play with things like this, you gotta learn. A man like me, when you put him down, you gotta put dirt on top of him, my man, or he'll get back up and come back to haunt you. What I'm trying to say is this. You give me yours, now I'm gonna come get mine.
Talk about a guy obsessed. Jake the Snake Roberts is in fact that. When you do a job on somebody, you better do it 100%, Mr. DiBiase, or the guy's gonna come back to haunt you, and you're gonna have to live with that. And I don't think Virgil will be able to do anything about it. Coming up right now, an outstanding individual, an outstanding athlete, referring to Rick Martel, taking on the youngster, Tim Horner. Let's go to ringside.
Set to go with what we believe will be a tremendous match. Rick Martel pointing the finger at his manager, the slickster, as Rick Martel comes into the ring, going up against the youngster, Tim Horner. Martel has been really on a roll, Alfred, and I don't think there's any question that the alliance between Martel and Slickster has really advanced his career.
Oh, absolutely. He's given Martel such an intensity when he's inside the ring. And Martel is a very, very cocky, confident wrestler now. It shows, and it shows in the results too. He hasn't lost a single match since Slick took over his managerial duties.
But you can better believe Tim Horner's not going to be intimidated at all by the music, by the Slickster, nor by the caliber of athlete of Rick Martel. Martel with a great.
And look at that. There's a beautiful reverse there by Horner. As fast as Martel was moving, Horner was moving just as fast. Indeed, he perfected that really good move.
Tried the snapmare again. Martel tumbles out of that one after Horner held the ropes. And Martel with a high five to his manager.
Yes, Slick is there, instilling more confidence into Martel. But Martel's going to be really on top of his form if he's hoping to beat Horner, which obviously he is, because Horner is a brilliant young wrestler. Later on, I'm sure we'll see some tremendous moves from this young man.
Big clothesline that missed. Great cartwheel from Martel. You know, you talked about the confidence that he is instead. Oh, there's a clothesline. And down goes Martel. I was just going to ask the question, Alfred, by instilling this confidence or maybe cockiness, do you think that he has taken away from his concentration in the ring?
That's difficult to answer, quite honestly. He did there, obviously. I mean, he was caught napping by young Tim Horner and knocked clean through the ropes. But look, he's come back with a different attitude now.
We talk about the confidence of Rick Martel. No doubt when you hear the man talk. Here's a pre-recorded comments from Rick Martel and the Slickster himself.
You know, Rick, this is the most disgusting poster I've ever seen.
That's right, Slick. This is the worst I've ever seen. No one will ever buy a beefcake poster. As you know, Slick, they're on their knees begging me to do a poster, but I turn them down because the fans don't deserve to have a Martel poster.
Wow, you're talking about arrogance. Now, what about that? And what do you think Brutus thinks about that?
I would imagine he thinks quite a bit, because Brutus obviously is watching this wrestling match just as keenly as we are, and he will see that I don't think Brutus is going to like that one iota.
And I think the first thing that Brutus would be thinking would be that, well, Martel could use a trim or two.
Yes. As a matter of fact, I think he could. There is one thing, of course, Martel better keep his mind and his attention at the moment solely on this young man. He's against Tim Horner, because if he allows his attention to waver again, like he did a little while ago, he'll get caught again.
Well, Martel talked about
Beefcake's poster. And realistically, when you look at the two men, Beefcake and Martel, there are a lot of similarities as far as wrestling style and looks. And what a great contest it would be as we see Horner tied up in the corner.
Yes, what two magnificently conditioned athletes that would be in the ring at the same time. Martel against Beefcake. Beefcake at the moment, I've never seen him looking so good. He is doing so well. He's probably the most advanced in all the World Wrestling Federation as far as form and victories are concerned. But Martel, look at his record.
Right, he's up top now. High-risk maneuver right here. He's going to try to come off on a prone Tim Horner, and he dodges. With a leg right across the chest. Three, count is coming. Yes, there it is.
The winner, Rick Martel.
Rick Martel. He tossed down the poster of the barber, Brutus Beefcake, and there's no question, Brutus got to be looking on and realizing that Martel is a threat every time he hits the ring. And Albert, this was a good win against a quality athlete like Tim Horner.
It was indeed. Look at Martel, another drip of sweat upon that body, that magnificent frame. I'd like to see exactly how he took control of this match at the end and beat his man. Watch the tremendous precision there. Absolutely accurate to the last detail. A nice cartwheel that happened earlier in this belt, showing the cockiness of Martel. A tremendous wrestler, a great victory for Rick Martel.
Obvious to everyone sitting at home there, munching on your provolone sandwiches, that Rick Martel is one of the greatest athletes to come down the pike in quite some time. Obviously in the best condition of his entire life right now here in the World Wrestling Federation, and no question in my mind that it's just, whenever the day comes, it's inevitable that we'll see some gold around the waist of Rick Martel. We'll be right back after this.
Think about what's on his mind. Think about this as he misses the big splash. That Dusty Rhodes could be lurking somewhere in the background. He's done it before as Dusty Rhodes, and that may be...
Feature time here this week on Primetime Wrestling, and of course it's the Mighty Hercules taking on the Big Boss Man. I would assume, I don't know this for a fact, but I would think that the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, would be watching this match very closely. Not only that he has a thing going with the Big Boss Man, but he also is a personal friend of the Mighty Hercules. So, a lot at stake here. We're going to find out what happens in this one. This is it. This is our biggie. Let's go to ringside.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall. About to be
in this feature event, we are really in for a treat, Lord Alfred Hayes, because here comes the Big Boss Man as he leads in the Slickster, and the man he'll oppose, you will see in just a moment, under the banner of the World Wrestling Federation, these two men walk in, is the Mighty Hercules. It should be a great confrontation.
Oh, absolutely. This man is so colossal, so strong. He's very agile for a big man, well in excess of that 300-pound mark, big, tall man. Hercules is going to have his work cut out for him tonight against that fellow there, the Big Boss Man.
Look at this, he's threatening Mike McGurk. Now, she's never hurt anyone.
And his opponent.
And he had a threatening word to say to her. What do you think about that?
Not very gentlemanly.
Not at all. Here we go, the Mighty Hercules making his way into the ring here. As the fans here in Fresno come to their feet, the Mighty Hercules, a very confident, very powerful man. Into the ring he goes against the Big Boss Man. If you want to get into accessories, it might be the chain against the nightstick here.
Yes. He is a confident man, that huge chain. Look at the way he's wielding that around. He said he's cleared the ring, and I don't blame everybody for running.
The Slickster and that man, the Big Boss Man, take the low road as Hercules comes in, paying no attention to the referee, Dave Hebner. And a warning here that the chain has to leave. Well, the chain, I'm sure, will stay around if the nightstick and those handcuffs you see on his belt stay around, and I know they will. I know another man who realizes they will, and his name is Dusty Rhodes, who carries some nightsticks and handcuffs of his own that he got right from the Big Boss Man.
Yes, and a little headwear, too.
That's right.
And Dusty Rhodes, of course, will be watching this match to see how the Boss Man fares. I'm sure he's hoping somewhere that he'll get a chance to go against the Boss Man, and he certainly deserves to have that opportunity.
One thing you might say, Alfred, is that the annex and the things that have happened by Dusty Rhodes has really given this big boss man a very despicable outlook on things, but I would say he's always been that way.
Yes.
With or without Dusty Rhodes. It just maybe the intensity is there a little bit more now.
Well, he works himself up into such a state, the big boss man, and that's the way he goes into battle. He gets that going for himself. He infuriates his opponents. But I must say that Dusty Rhodes has tremendous courage and a lot of grit and determination to actually chase this man down the way he is doing.
There's one man who's not intimidated. We saw momentarily right there that Hercules was not at all intimidated by the verbal abuse he received from the boss man. And these two big men lock up, and basically, as we expected, a stalemate.
Yes, that was definitely a standoff in strength there. And the boss man's trying to think that out. Look at him. You can see the thought running through his head. This is a powerful fellow I'm up against.
Well, let's see what happens here with another tie-up. Here we go, the big boss man and Hercules pushing, pulling, pushing. And now it's Herc into the corner, into the neutral corner. And this is where he could be in a lot of trouble. Well, he pushed right out. Not a bad move at all by Hercules. He did not put his hands up and allow Bossman to get a slap in. His first move was to push out.
It was indeed, and that was a very, very shrewd move there by Hercules. It shows that he's done his homework on the Bossman. He's not going to give him an opportunity to get in a sucker blow against him. And the Bossman pushed Hercules back into the corner then simply by the superior weight advantage that he has. Strength? No, definitely not. Not more than an ounce in strength against Hercules, who is in such splendid form.
And holding on to the side headlock as the boss man tried to send him into the near side ropes. Hercules, those massive arms around the boss man. As you see him cinching up, the boss man certainly the head in weight, and Hercules, I guess, in muscle development, but both men appear to be strength-wise equally matched here. As Hercules does not let go, the boss man still tried to shrug him off.
Tony, I wonder what's going through boss man's mind now. He's tested the firepower of Hercules. He came out unsuccessful in that encounter, in this strength encounter. Now he's wrapped in a headlock. He can't get out of that. All of this is most unusual because the boss man... Oh, my goodness! I spoke too soon.
You really did.
Oh, gosh, that was a beautiful move there by such a huge man.
And Hercules with a high-risk maneuver that did not pay off for him at all. Going right at the boss man, right after his power. But also, you think about what's on his mind. Think about this as he misses a big splash. That Dusty Rhodes could be lurking somewhere in the background. He's done it before as Dusty Rhodes. And that may be grating on the mind of the boss man as he misses two moves to follow up a great move, three of them now. And what had been a good move has turned against him now.
It has indeed. And he can think himself lucky he had Hercules off balance for a moment or two there, because Hercules is coming back so strongly. If he hadn't have been dazed for a second or two, this bout might be history.
Hercules with a couple of blows into the corner. The big wind-up from Herc. Here we go. Right hand found its mark. And the big boss man is wobbly. Hercules, can he get him off his feet with a clothesline? He's going to try again. Yes, he does. Oh, the boss man hit hard. The fans really erupt now as Hercules, my goodness, says he's going to pick this man up.
What an unusual situation the boss man finds himself in now.
Well, wait a minute. What happened here? Hercules turned his attention completely away from the boss man and right to the slickster, the boss man with a nightstick on the back of the neck. Well, Hercules can only blame himself for this. His attention completely away from what happened, the nightstick to the back of the neck, and it is all over Lord Alfred Hayes. The boss man earned this one. He went right after the slickster, did Hercules, and he is paying for it right
well,
now.
Well, Tony, Slick hurled an insult out of him that I couldn't possibly repeat on the air, and that really got to Hercules, and it was something to do about his close relatives. I don't know if you can understand that at all, but that really incensed Hercules, and he wasn't going to have that said, and he went straight after Slick, but that was to his own downfall.
Look here, Alfred. He wanted to handcuff Hercules. As a matter of fact, got the handcuffs around the left wrist, but Hercules not giving it at all. Hercules fighting back with that handcuffs to Hunter. Look at the slickster. He sends him for a ride down. Hercules now with a clothesline, and Boss Man goes down. And maybe if Boss Man wanted to hand out some justice, he has picked the wrong man, because Hercules in the center of the ring is an angry man.
Indeed he is, and he was only finishing off what he started 5 minutes or so before that. Tremendous clothesline. He really had Big Boss Man beaten. He allowed his attention to be diverted, and unfortunately for Hercules, that's going to go down as a loss in his record, but even so, a moral victor in my view.
And there is no question that now he has dropped a nightstick and a pair of handcuffs to Hercules, as he did to Dusty Rhodes. Yes, that's right, there is your winner, the Big Boss Man, but it would not happen. The justice that he likes to dish out afterwards did not come about, but we're gonna take a look at some of the things that went down here, Alfred.
Yes, let's have a look at this. Slick had hurled that terrible insult that incensed the Hercules to such a height of anger, and that allowed his attention to be diverted, and that was all that the Big Boss Man needed. He grabbed that nightstick. However, it was a victory for that huge man, the Big Boss Man, and he is a victor, even though Hercules fared so well.
Well, the record books won't tell what actually happened. It'll just say that the Big Boss Man got a win over the mighty Hercules, but Big Boss Man will be thinking about this one for quite a few weeks to come. At the same time, he'll be worrying about where Mr. Americana is, Dusty Rhodes, and what's on his mind, because there's a vendetta to be settled there, a big feud going on. Well, folks, that does it for this Labor Day weekend edition of Primetime Wrestling. Hope you all enjoy it. I'm sure you did. Next week, we'll be right back here with all the superstars of the World Wrestling Federation. And I can just about guarantee you that Hot Rod will be back sitting on his little director's chair over there. And perhaps even the Weasel, Bobby the Brain Heenan, will make an appearance due to a diminishing number of requests, I'm sure. So until then, this is Gorilla Monsoon saying, have a happy holiday weekend. Make it a safe one. Don't drink and drive. See y'all.